Welcome to RIC and Earth Day celebration here at Reformation. We'll start with our thanksgiving for baptism. You call us through the waters of baptism to be our authentic selves. You called us holy and set us on a path to manifest your revolution on earth. We praise you for the waters of life that nourish people, animals, and plants. We praise you for the streams, oceans, and lakes, and for the rain and snow that give life to every living thing. From the waters above and the waters below, you make sacred our bond with water. Through the waters of the flood and the parting of the seas, you showed us promise to be true. In the waters of baptism, you claimed us and called us each by our true name. Through baptism into the body of Christ, you transformed our lives and made us whole. Send now your Spirit to move in our midst and soak us with your gifts of mercy, love, and grace. Amen. The first hymn is Morning Has Broken, 556.
A reading from Psalm 139. Lord, you have searched me out. O Lord, you have known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all of my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, O Lord, know it all together. You encompass me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. Where can I go then from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I climb up to heaven, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand hold me fast. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well. My body was not hidden from you while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth. Search me out, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my restless thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll begin the reconciling in Christ portion of the service with congregational responses of the words from our welcome statement. That will be followed by some brief comments, such as a quote, maybe an example, or some general background information. So let us begin.
We extend hospitality, encouragement, and full participation.
We've had years of welcoming visitors and members who have been encouraged to participate and serve in the life of this congregation. 3 years ago, we chose to extend the welcome to those persons who are part of the LGBTQIA plus community. More recently, we have included individuals and families who are Black, Indigenous, and people of color, who for generations have been impacted by systemic racial injustice due to a variety of conditions and situations. Offer encouragement to all.
We celebrate as children of God that all persons are created in God's image.
From the New International Version of the Bible, from Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we read, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness." We can join together for our hymn.
We embrace each person's
sacred wisdom. A Methodist theologian who was associated with the World Council of Churches in the 80s and 90s, his name was Wesley Arriaga, and he said, "We Christians need to learn that people of other faiths are not only created by, but also sustained by God the Creator." Embrace wisdom.
We welcome persons of all sexual orientations,
gender identities, and gender
expressions
to share in our community life. You might think that this welcome refers to the LGBTQIA plus community. It does. But it's more than that. It's everybody. All human beings have a sexual orientation. They are either straight or gay. All human beings have a gender identity. They either identify with or differ from the M or F that is on their birth certificate. They then identify their gender by being boy, man, or girl, woman, and they compare that to the birth certificate. All human beings have a gender expression, which is based upon their gender identity. They express themselves to the world as either masculine or feminine. Welcome everyone. Another hymn, all are welcome.
We declare
that we will welcome persons of all abilities, of any ethnicity, economic status, family makeup, or age. Because of white supremacy over the years, some of these individuals and families have been scorned by society. We can commit to help dismantle those oppressive systems and practices in ourselves, in our church, and in our community. Help us to accept those who are different.
We commit
to study, to prayer, and to action so that we may become anti-racist individuals in an anti-racist church, and we will work to do away with injustice. Two of our members have participated in the anti-racism programs offered by the Synod. Through those programs, we've been introduced to Reformation Milwaukee, an ongoing, though limited, connection continues with that congregation. Open our minds to new ventures.
We are open.
To the leadership of all rostered clergy, including those who are Black, Indigenous, and people of color. Having recently submitted our MET documentation to the Synod, this goal is at the forefront as we await interviews with interested and available candidates. Guide the call committee. And now a hymn. In the movie, The Ten Commandments, Pharaoh says, "So it is written, so it is done." Our welcome statement has been written. However, the phrase, "nothing is happening," might be the more appropriate mantra for our congregation. You may be asking yourself,
what was the point of going through the RIC process? All the time and energy that we spent, and what do we have to show for it? Nothing has changed. Not even straight white people are knocking on our doors, wanting to join us.
You would be correct, but individually we have changed. Our eyes, our hearts, and our minds have been opened to new ideas. Our attitudes have gradually changed to accept those ideas. Injustice and inequity will be overcome. We continue with another hymn as we transition to the Earth Day portion of our service.
We join in the responsive reading of Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is thy name in all the earth. Thou whose glory above the heavens is chanted by the mouths of babes and infants, thou hast founded a bulwark because of thy foes. When I look at thy heaven, the work of thy fingers, the moon and stars, which thou hast established. Yet thou hast made them little less than God,
and dost crown them with glory and honor.
Thou hast given them dominion over the works of thy hands.
Thou hast put all things under their feet.
All sheep and oxen, and also beasts of the field,
the birds of the air, and the fish of the seas, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is thy name in all the earth.
What Trees Can Do For You, an article by Dan Lamb, the CEO of the Arbor Day Foundation. It could be said that trees naturally call for our attention as they climb up toward the sky with their arms outstretched. Yet it is still easy for us to ignore them. As we bustle through our day-to-day lives, trees seem to play the role of a backdrop, an insignificant set piece in the stage production of our society. Nothing could be further from the truth. Trees are so instrumental to the quality and health of our lives, our homes, and our planet. Rooted to a single spot, they seem very still. But that stillness is not synonymous with laziness. Trees are rarely idle. In fact, they are the workhorses of the environment, as the impact of their hard work carries miles further than the ground in which they stand. There is a transformation that is spurred by planting a tree. Globally, trees are the most scalable and cost-effective tool in the fight against climate change. Trees clean the air, vacuum up carbon, they foster biodiversity, and support critical habitats. For example, the ring-tailed lemurs are considered one of the most endangered creatures on the planet. A big reason why is half the forests they depend on in Madagascar off the east coast of Africa have been cut down. Lemurs aren't alone when it comes to dependency on trees. Trees are home to 80% of all animals, plants, and insects that live on the land. That include butterflies, bats, bears, frogs, and birds, not to mention the neighborhood squirrels seeking escape from your dog in the backyard. Though humans aren't always dependent on the treetops for shelter, trees do save lives. Reports indicated in 2022 alone, with the heat waves across Europe, caused an estimated 20,000 deaths. Scientists pointed to trees as a way to combat these urban heat islands, saying that if Europe would increase their tree canopy by 30%, it would prevent thousands of deaths. Being around trees can also improve a person's blood pressure, mental health, and boost your creativity. In fact, doctors in Canada are so convinced of nature's benefits for the mind and body They started prescribing patients free passes to the national park system so they could enjoy all of nature. Where there's a need, trees can fill in. In some communities, trees are an important food source. In others, they're a symbol of resiliency following a devastating tragedy. When planted near streams and rivers, they clean and filter the waters. When planted in communities of need, they usher in equality. And a bonus for homeowners, trees can even save you money. That's right, when planted in the right place, a tree can help bring down your energy costs for your home. No coupon necessary. Now forget the backdrop. It's time to put trees in the spotlight. The Arbor Day Foundation is dedicated to this exact mission. They inspire people to plant trees, nurture them, and celebrate them. We know there's never been a more important time for trees, and we know there's never been a more important time for mankind to engage its role as environmental stewards. This isn't a one-sided relationship. What we give to nature, we will receive from nature tenfold. So as springtime once again comes, and goes and comes and goes here, and take a moment and appreciate all a tree can be.
St. Francis, you know all about gardens and nature. What in the world is going on down there in the Midwest? What happened to the dandelions, violets, thistle, and stuff I started eons ago? I had a perfect no-maintenance garden plan. Those plants grow in any type of soil, withstand drought, and multiply with abandon. The nectar from the long-lasting blossoms attracted butterflies, honeybees, and flocks of songbirds. I expected to see a garden of colors by now, but all I see are those green rectangles.
It's the tribes that settled there, Lord, the suburbanites. They started calling your flowers weeds and went to great extent to kill them and replace them with grass.
Grass? But it's so boring. It's not colorful. It doesn't attract butterfly birds and bees. Only grubs and sod worms. It's temperamental with temperatures. Do these suburbanites really want all that grass growing there?
Apparently so, Lord. They go to great pains to grow it and keep it green. They begin each spring by fertilizing grass and poisoning any other plant that crops up in the lawn.
The spring rains and cool weather probably make the grass grow really fast. That must make the suburbanites happy.
Apparently not, Lord. As soon as it grows a little, they cut it, sometimes twice a week.
They cut it? Do they then bale it like hay?
Not exactly, Lord. Most of them rake it up and put it in bags.
They bag it? Why? Is it a cash crop? Do they will it? Do they sell it?
No, sir. Just the opposite. They pay to throw it away.
Now let me get this straight. They fertilize grass so it will grow, and when it does grow, they cut it off and pay to throw it away?
Yes, sir.
These suburbanites must be relieved in the summer when we cut back on the rain and turn up the heat. That surely slows the growth and saves them a lot of work.
You aren't going to believe this, Lord. When the grass stops growing so fast, they drag out those hoses and pay more money to water it so they can continue to mow it and pay to get rid of it.
What nonsense. At least they kept some of the trees. That was sheer stroke of genius, if I do say so myself. The trees grow leaves in the spring to provide beauty and shade in the summer. In the autumn, they fall to the ground and form a neutral blanket to keep moisture in the soil and protect the trees and bushes. Plus, as they rot, the leaves form compost to enhance the soil. It's a natural circle of life.
You better sit down, Lord. The suburbanites have drawn a new circle. As soon as the leaves fall, they rake them into great piles and have them hauled away.
No. What do they do to protect the shrub and tree roots in the winter and keep the soil moist and loose?
After throwing away your leaves, they go out and buy something they call mulch. They haul it home and spread it around in place of the leaves.
And where do they get this mulch?
They cut down trees and grind them up.
Enough. I don't want to think about this anymore. St. Francis, you're in charge of the arts. What movie have you scheduled for us tonight?
St. Catherine? Oh. Dumb and Dumber, Lord. It's a real stupid movie about...
Never mind. I think I just heard the whole story.
Let's rise and affirm our faith with the Earth Day. We believe that God creates all things, renews all things, and celebrates all things. We believe Earth is a sanctuary, a sacred planet filled with God's presence, a home for us to share with our kin. We believe that God became flesh and blood, became a part of earth, a human being called Jesus Christ, who lived and breathed and spoke among us, suffered and died on a cross for all human beings and for all creation. We believe that the risen Jesus is the Christ at the core of creation, reconciling all things to God, renewing all creation, and filling the universe. We believe that the Spirit renews life in creation, groans in empathy with a suffering creation, and waits for us for the rebirth of creation. We believe that Christ, we will rise, and with Christ, we will celebrate a new creation. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers. She can stay back there.
First of all, as we begin our prayers, we want to pray for Mike, who is Audrey's son-in-law and has had a heart attack. Wise Creator, we stand in awe of the world beyond us and the world we live in and the world beneath our feet. Give us the wisdom to know that we are standing on holy ground. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, you know how interwoven our lives are with the earth itself. Give us eyes to see as you see and move to act in the best interest of all creation. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our pastors, our deacons, our bishops, and our church leaders, that they may lead us to be a loving and welcoming community in Jesus Christ. We give thanks for all of our RLC partners. We pray that the whole church may someday be a refuge for all our LGBTOIA+. Sorry, I don't know all of the letters. Hi, sweetie. Anyway, when we pray, we pray for all, and God is Lord of all. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the sustainability of our earthly home. Guide us to care for creation. Be mindful of waste, carbon emissions, and the impact of these sins on poor and marginalized communities. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our siblings all around the world. We pray that all of us find our true peace and wholeness in ourselves, in you. We pray that our faith community and its ministries uplift and care for all of your for all of your diverse created beings, and move us to act in the best interests of all creation. Lord, in your mercy. Holy and loving God, precious Jesus, your thoughts are very deep, and your love for us and all creation is boundless. Receive our prayers and our praise in the name of our Son and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord and the world. Thanks be to God.